Welcome to worship here at Woodland. It's wonderful to be together again on God's day. Let's prepare ourselves for worship. I'd like to share with you that the flowers in the sanctuary today are given to the glory of God by Debbie Blackman in honor of all the Woodland staff and their work on the online services and keeping us all connected. And now let's prepare ourselves for worship as we listen to our prelude.
Please join us for the hymn of praise, Near to the Heart of God.
Near to the heart. Our Old Testament reading for today is from the book of Ruth, chapter 2, verses 8 through 12. And it reads, "Then Boaz said to Ruth, 'Now listen, my daughter, do not go to glean in another field or leave this one, but keep close to my young women. Keep your eyes on the field that is being reaped and follow behind them. I have ordered the young men not to bother you. If you get thirsty, go to the vessels and drink from what the young men have drawn.' Then Ruth fell prostrate, her face to the ground, and said to him, 'Why have I found favor in your sight, that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner?' But Boaz answered her, 'All that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband has been fully told to me, and how you left your father and mother in your native land and came to a people that you did not know before. May the Lord reward you for your deeds, and may you have full reward from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come for refuge.'" The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And now we come to our time of prayer. Let us begin with our prayer, our congregational prayer. Let us pray. O eternal God, in whose appointment our life stands, and who committed our work to us, we commit our cares to you. We thank you that we are your children and that you have assured us that while we are intent on your will, you will heed our wants. Fill us with that compassion for others' troubles, which come from forgetfulness of our own, with the charity of those who know their own unworthiness, and with the glad hope of the children of eternity. And to you, the beginning and the end, Lord of the living, refuge of the dying, be thanks and praise forever. And our gracious Lords, we do thank you. We thank you for your presence and your love. We thank you for your calling, Lord. It draws us together in this place. We thank you, Lord, for your presence that overwhelms us and lifts us up. We thank you, Lord, that if we listen to your voice and be guided by your Spirit, then we will do the right thing. We will care for people as you would have us care for them. We will reach out to all people with the same love and compassion. We reach out to those we know and our friends. We will reach out to everyone so that everyone ultimately could become our friends in you. That everyone we meet, Lord, even the stranger, is a potential brother and sister in Christ, as we go to them and share with them the love of Jesus and help them to be drawn into your love and your presence. We thank you, Lord, that you're equipping us and preparing us even now for what you have in store for us. As you prepare us to be an answer to someone's prayer, Lord, to be an instrument of your grace in someone's life, to be a comfort of your Spirit to a troubled heart. And Lord, as we thank you for what you're doing and preparing and getting ready to send us out, we thank you, Lord, that we lift up those who need a special touch upon their bodies, their minds, and their spirits, that even now they feel the power of prayer. They feel the love of the church. They feel, Lord, that not only are you there with them, but you're there in the hearts and minds of your people who are lifting them up in your name and for your purpose. Believing, Lord, and celebrating, Lord, not just what you've done, but yes, Lord, we thank you. Not just what you're doing, yes, Lord, we thank you, but all that you're about to do as we allow ourselves to be an instrument of your delivering power, love, peace, and presence. And Lord, as we thank you as you work your work through the hearts and minds of those instruments of grace you use to be instruments of hope for others. We thank you, Lord, that we can testify. We have to testify to who we are in you, that we are the body of Christ, that we are the children of God, that we're the family of God, we're the people of God. We are, Lord Jesus, your very disciples, your followers, walking in your footsteps, following your example. And we testify to our oneness in this, Lord, by sharing together in the very prayer that you, Lord Jesus, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Today we're outside filming for this Sunday, and as you can see, I'm surrounded by the trees here. And these trees, or bushes, some may call them, because they're rose bushes, remind me of a story in the Bible of Moses. Moses was out in the wilderness, and as he was there, he saw this bush that was on fire, covered in flames, yet the bush was not burning. It was just there. And then he heard a voice speak to him and saying, Moses, take off your shoes, for the place where you're standing is holy ground. God used that burning bush that day to talk to Moses and to call him. Now, we may not see bushes on fire, or we may see bushes on fire, and we won't maybe have the same experience that Moses did. But yet God still speaks to us. I want you to think for a minute, how can God, or how does God speak to us today? Sometimes it's in the voice of your parents. It's in His Bible, His Word, where He teaches us to love one another or go out and make disciples. That means go out and tell others about Him and about His love for us. He may use it in a sermon from Pastor Michael, or a children's sermon that you hear from me, or in a youth sermon from Mr. Alec, or maybe in a song that you hear. God calls each one of us to do something for Him. Most importantly, He still speaks to us and tells us to love others and go out and make disciples. So today, think about how God can speak to you and how God can use you to grow His family. Let's say a prayer. Gracious God, we thank you that you use all sorts of ways to reach us. Sometimes a burning bush, sometimes a song, or a word from a friend. Thank you that you still speak to us today. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Hey, good morning, guys. This week, I'm really excited to say that we actually have youth this evening at 5:30 p.m. in Wesley Hall. We have some great food by Miss Barb, and we're going to be talking about relationships. During the pandemic, relationships have been tough. They've been a struggle for many of us. I'm sure we've realized that some of our friends that we thought we were close with beforehand, we're not as close with. Or we might have found out someone that we didn't know very well, we've gotten to know so much better. But tonight we're going to be speaking about meaningful relationships, how to develop them between us and other people, and how those skills can help us better build our relationship with Christ.
Now we come to this time of receiving our tithes and offerings as we bring our best offering to God, as we sacrifice ourselves for the glory of God, that we may lift up our church as an instrument of giving and serving and caring. Let's prepare ourselves for receiving of the offering. And there are several ways you can give. You can give online. You can give by calling the church office and having someone come by and pick up your offering. You can mail your offering in, or you can follow the instructions online for texting. Let's prepare ourselves now for our offerings. Let us pray. Our gracious Lord, we thank you. We ask your blessing upon the offering. We ask your blessing upon the givers. We ask your blessing upon us as your church, that we will go forth and faithfully use the gifts that you have brought, that we may go forth as ministers of yours, Lord, in service and care and love for our church family, for our community and beyond, as we reach out in love. We thank you for all these things and the opportunity that has been given us. In the name above all names of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now we come to our reading of the Gospel, Mark chapter 15, verses 33 through 39. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sponge with some wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now as we come to this scripture and we start looking at these two sections of scripture, the Old Testament and New Testament, we see people gathered in one place. In the New Testament scripture, is at the cross of Christ. Is at the cross. As we're at the cross, we're facing Christ. They're facing Christ. As we go to the cross, we face Christ. But in this story, you have everybody in the same place, but people are seeing different things. It all depends on where your heart is. It all depends on who has your heart. It all depends on how open you are to letting God show up in your life. If you have Christ in your life, then you know what it is to be touched by Christ. You know what it is to be embraced by Christ. You know what it is to love like Jesus loves. You know what it is to give of yourself for others because Christ gave himself for you. You know what that feels like. So it makes a difference in how you see the world. We begin to see the world as Christ sees the world. But in this story at the cross in Mark, we have these people there, religious people. That's one of the groups. There were actually three groups there. There was those who were religious and who had an agenda and felt like Jesus was not right. There were those, and they wanted Jesus to prove them wrong. They wanted Jesus to do something that would just so impress them, or God to do something that would so impress them that they would accept Christ. But God would have to impress them. God would have to prove himself to them. God would have to do something to prove who he is and who Jesus is. They also had their Bible. They read their Bible all the time, the religious people did. And so they were sure they had all the answers because they believed everything in that book. But of course, they believed everything the way they've been taught to interpret everything. And they had picked the scriptures they liked to read and they've ignored the scriptures they didn't like to read. But they had a scripture that said Elijah the prophet must come back before the Messiah. And even to this day, there are religious people who will say the reason we cannot believe that Jesus is Lord and Savior is because Elijah hasn't physically, supernaturally, the person that was Elijah has not come back. Of course, we have a spiritual statement from Jesus that Elijah had come back and that he came, that the spirit of Elijah had been inside of John the Baptist and that John the Baptist came in the spirit of Elijah to prepare the way of the Lord. But for the religious people of the day, that was a very liberal statement to make. That was claiming that there was a spiritual meaning, not a literal meaning about Elijah the prophet. And they were offended by that suggestion. And so they ignored Jesus, largely because of a verse in the Bible that they thought justified their ignoring. But these religious people wanted to believe, so they go to the cross and they're saying, "Lord, just let Elijah come. Maybe Elijah will come. And when Jesus cried out to God, they thought maybe he's crying out to Elijah. Maybe he's asking Elijah to come and take him off the cross. So let's wait. Let's watch. Let's see if he does. So they were looking hard and waiting for this great thing to happen so they would believe. Others just didn't like Jesus. They thought he was a troublemaker. They thought his purpose was to destroy their country. They believed that he was going to mess up their country. He was causing riots, they thought, even though that wasn't true. He was trying to stir up trouble where there hadn't been trouble before. He was trying to convince people to believe things that they never believed before. And though they, the religious leaders, had gotten people calmed down to believing the right way, the way they thought was right, and here's Jesus throwing a monkey wrench in it by saying crazy things, like it's all right to do certain things on the Sabbath when the Bible very clearly says you couldn't. Here's this Jesus saying it's all right to eat things that the Bible and the Old Testament had proclaimed unclean, because he said it's not what goes into your mouth that corrupts you, but what comes out of your mouth. Do you understand? It's who you are, not what you say you believe, that testifies to God. That was radical. So you have people who wanted to see him dead, and they were happy to be there to watch him die on the cross. There were others who wanted to see him impress them and do something amazing so that they could believe and follow him, but he would have to do it on their schedule and in their way, and he would have to profess the beliefs they wanted to hear out of his mouth. But then there was someone else there, and that was the centurion. There were others there, other soldiers and others around him, but there was a centurion there who also became part of the story. He also was looking, and he wasn't there expecting anything. He was there doing his job. Perhaps he had a heart. Maybe he was a caring man. Maybe he really didn't like this part of the job, that he actually had to participate in the execution of people, which maybe deep down he felt that was wrong, to take someone's life, especially in a way that was very torturing, as the crucifixion was. Maybe he knew that a lot of poor people end up crucified more than any rich people or wealthy people or connected people. Maybe he knew there were a lot of innocent people who were dying through that process. I don't know, but I do know he was there and he was looking. And we're told in the scripture he was facing Jesus. Very significant that the scripture put that he was facing Jesus at the time. As centurion, he would have been over the soldiers and taking care of things, making sure everything ran well. He didn't have to be watching, but the scripture says he was facing Jesus. And something happened. It didn't happen to the religious people who were wanting something spectacular and supernatural and something to impress them, to get them to believe. It didn't happen to those who hated him and were wanting to see him die because they saw him as a threat, a danger to their society, to their country, to the world. It happened to a centurion, a foreigner, someone who was an outsider, someone who wasn't a traditional believer, who didn't believe, hadn't believed, but something happened. In the Old Testament scripture, we have the story of Boaz and Ruth, and Ruth, you know, she's got her own book in the Bible, Ruth. And she was an outsider. She was a stranger. She was an immigrant. She was one who did not belong. And they called them strangers not because people didn't know them. Many people knew Naomi, who was from the area, and they knew that Ruth was her daughter-in-law and that both of them were widows, and that they were living together, and that Ruth was trying to take care of her. They knew all this stuff, so they knew who she was, but she was still called a stranger because she was strange to that land, which meant that she wasn't from there. She wasn't born there. And here she was. In that story, Boaz is looking out. He's like the centurion. He's looking out, and he's seeing things that other people don't see. Other people looked at Ruth and saw a foreigner. They saw someone who was there to take away from the people who lived there. They saw her as someone who's going to be gleaning, is what they did. They gleaned food out of the fields, and they would see her taking food that natural born people would not be able to get because she was there, this foreigner. taking their food as she went in there to get food for her and Naomi. And so they were not happy. A lot of people weren't happy. They saw someone there to cause trouble. They saw someone there who was interfering. They saw someone there to be afraid of or be nervous about because she was a stranger to their land. She wasn't one of them, they would say. But here's Boaz looking and seeing the same thing, but he sees something different. Seeing this in the same situation, looking at the same person, he sees completely differently. Apparently, he's been touched by the grace of God. Apparently, he knows what it is to have God grab a hold of him. He knows what it is to look through the eyes of God when he looks. And he's wanted also to look into it, to find out who she is before he allows any people to judge her or condemn her or attack her or say she doesn't belong or she's no good. And he found out about her. So he tells her one day because she's gleaning. Now, back to the word gleaning. Gleaning was something that people did to get food for themselves if they didn't have a field of their own. And Israel and Judah had a policy at one time that they would always allow so much of their crop to remain in the field so that the poor and the strangers and those who don't have a field and don't have the support and don't have family to take care of them or help them, that they can go into the fields and get enough to feed themselves. It was a policy. So she was doing that. And she wasn't just doing it at Boaz's field. She was doing it at other fields. She was going from field to field. But when Boaz saw her, he investigated about her, learned about her from people who knew Naomi and her. And then he told her one day, you don't have to go out into other fields looking for food for you and Naomi. You can stay in my fields, these fields that I'm responsible for. You can stay there. And you can get actually go in the field when the regular workers go into the field so you can get some good, the good of it, not just the leftover crumbs, and you'll be able to take care. He said, I've heard about you. I know that you care for your mother-in-law. I know that you've been very decent and loving and caring to her. I know that you left your land. You left your mom and your dad and your family to come here with Naomi. You chose to come here and take care of her and be with her. And you chose to come here. Why in the world would you want to come here knowing that there'll be people who will reject you and exclude you? And it must be because there's something more going on than just you making a decision to come here. And he began to see that God must have his arms around her. God has brought her here. And you remember when Naomi told her that I'm going back home and told all of her daughter-in-laws to turn and go back to their homes because they weren't from that area. And others did, but not Ruth. And Ruth said, your home, your people are my people, and your God will be my God. I'm going with you. And she came. And what we may not realize is that this person who everybody was rejecting, everybody was shunning, everybody was saying don't belong, everyone was saying she's taking away from me and from us, she was chosen to be here. And we know that she, I believe, is the great-grandmother of King David, according to the lineage of Jesus, because she's also in his lineage as one of his ancestors. She was meant to be one who would be an instrument in bringing about the birth of the Savior of the world, this outsider, this stranger, this immigrant, this person who came to the land. But Boaz looked through the eyes of faith in God and saw her goodness, saw what she was doing for her mother-in-law, saw the blessing that she had been, and also saw, he said, the wings of God around her. And he took care of her. And we know ultimately, eventually, they were married, and it was through that union and the children that came through them that led us to the lineage of made them part of the lineage of Jesus and the birth of the Savior of the world. Amazing. But Boaz saw something. Something happened right in front of him that didn't happen to anyone else around him. He saw God's act, God's presence in this person, this outsider, this person who had come into their land. And he began to realize that they were more blessed having her than they ever could have been without her. And he began, and we know that we are saved and we are blessed beyond measure because that God used Ruth as an instrument for the bringing of our Savior into the world as one of the instruments of grace for us. That's what happened. He saw something others didn't see. We get back to the New Testament story and we have the people looking out and seeing what they saw, but they didn't see Christ. They saw themselves. They thought about how this affects me. They thought about what this means for me and mine, and they did not see that they were standing right in front of the Savior of the world. They were standing in front of God incarnate, the second person of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and then there's God the Holy Spirit. But they were standing there and they could not see because their eyes hadn't been opened. You see, the miracle happens every day. It's not supernatural miracles where you can say, see, this amazing thing happened. Elijah came out of the sky and he landed there and he just took Jesus off that cross right there in front of us. It was the most amazing thing, and I believe. But Jesus actually spoke to a man's heart and whispered to him that he loved him and cared for him. God whispered to him, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased, as he had said on the mountain, as he said at the baptism. And now to this man's hearing in his own heart, this man is the Son of God. We know in that scripture also that when Jesus died, the moment he died, cried out his last and breathed his last, the veil in the temple was ripped in two, which means that when that was ripped in two, heaven and earth became connected as one. And people no longer had to go through some individual, some prophet who could tell you that they had talked to God and God had talked to them and they had a relationship with God and they will tell you what God is telling them. Now they can talk to God themselves. They can actually hear God's voice themselves. They can see heaven. They can see God right here in this life. We can notice the most miraculous things around us that others don't see because they're not looking at Christ in his eyes to see. This centurion was looking right at Jesus. And when he saw how he died, he said, surely this man is the Son of God. Christ, the veil has been removed. And when the veil was removed, this man who was looking at Jesus saw what he could see just a minute ago. The moment Jesus died, his eyes were open because the veil that separated. Because remember, the purpose of that veil was still symbolic, but in the temple, there was a veil to separate the Holy of Holies, where people believed that God was actually present, and the people couldn't go to that point. Only priests would have the opportunity to go in there by lots when it was their turn, like Zechariah, Abbas' dad, when he was informed that his son was going to be born and that he was going to be heir of the Lord. He was serving his term in the Holy of Holies, but average people never got that opportunity because God was so separate from them. They could never get that close to God. But then when Jesus came and offered God to us, and when he died on the cross, sacrificing himself, saying to us that he loves us so much that through the cross, all we have to do is let the cross become our cross and become crucified with him. And when we do that, we will be raised with him and we will see with him. And suddenly, it doesn't matter who we are or where we come from. We all become one, like the thief on the cross who said to Jesus, not, Lord, I am a thief. I've done bad things. He had said that. He knew that. He admitted that. He had a past and he had a recent past that got him crucified. But all he said to Jesus was, remember me. And Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. At the cross, this centurion saw. He saw heaven. He saw Christ. He saw Jesus for who he is. He saw because he looked. When the veil was removed, it opened up heaven for him, and he saw. And the others didn't see because they weren't looking. They were too busy judging and pointing fingers and condemning, and they were too busy making demands of God of what God has to do for them and telling God what they will believe as long as God does it their way. Let's remember that today, that there's miracles that will happen in everybody's life if we just let God speak to us. Let God show himself to us. And if we will look in his eyes, in the eyes of Christ, and then through his eyes, we look into the world and see the roofs out there. And we see those who are doing their best and whom maybe, just maybe, God has put in our way so that we could see God more clearly in them. And then, hopefully, God will put us in their way, other people's ways, so that people will see clearly Christ in us and be drawn to him. And may we look into the eyes of Jesus like that centurion so that we can know the presence of God right here with us, in us, through us, for us. And then let us be a witness to the world. And let us love as Jesus loves. Let's do this in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Please join us for the hymn of faith, How Great Thou Art.
And now as we prepare to go forth, let's go forth in the hands of Christ, in the arms of Christ. Let's let Christ open our eyes that we may see the world the way he does. We may see people in the world, all people, the way he sees them, and that we will love as he has loved us. Let us go forth ready to see through his eyes. Let us go forth realizing that that veil has been removed in the temple, and now we have direct access, and we can hear his voice if we listen. We can see his face if we'll look, and we can experience the holiness of his touch and the holiness of his care if we allow it to happen to us. And then we will see what no one else sees, perhaps because they're not looking. Every moment of every day, the very presence of Christ in our midst. And we'll go forth walking in his way and following his example. Go forth in the name of Jesus. Amen.